तो वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल ऑफ यू। आज आप सभी का स्वागत है इस वेबिनार में। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ आईसेट ग्रुप ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटीज आई अभिषेक श्रोती वेलकम ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स, पेरेंट्स, जॉब सीकर एंड डियर पार्टिसिपेंट्स ऑन दिस 26th वेबिनार ऑफ एजीयू कैरियर टॉक सीरीज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय आईसेट ग्रुप ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटीज। आईसेट ग्रुप ऑफ यूनिवर्सिटीज इज लीडिंग हायर एजुकेशन ग्रुप विद अ मिशन टू एस्टेब्लिश वर्ल्ड क्लास एंड अफोर्डेबल यूनिवर्सिटीज एट लोकेशन दैट आर इन डायर नीड ऑफ quality higher education. The group's ideology has always been to groom its student into responsible, proficient, and ethical professionals. With over three decades of unparalleled experience in skill development and job placements, ISET Group offers its students a range of opportunities through its extensive industry linkages and expertise in entrepreneurship development. Under ISET Group of Universities, we have five universities in four states of India. Rabindranath Tagore University in Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh, Dr. C.V. Raman University, Bilaspur, Chhattisgarh, ISEC University, Hazaribagh, Jharkhand, Dr. C.V. Raman University, Vaishali, Bihar, and Dr. C.V. Raman University, Khandwa, Madhya Pradesh. We all know that the entire nation is facing the challenges came from COVID-19, and there are also a big challenge for the students who are going to pass out in the coming days on how to get a good job in the industries. And this is also a tough time for the students who are going to take admission in different courses at various colleges and universities across India. Nowadays, technology playing an ever increasing role in reshaping academia and industry. And it is imperative that education institutions are able to impart students with the necessary skills to meet the demand of technology-centric workplace. Skill education today must not only aim to prepare the future workforce to fill the new and emerging roles, but must also cater to transforming and upskilling the current workforce with future-ready skills courses. AGU Career Talk Series is an initiative of ISET Group of Universities to help and guide the students of AGU to choose them the right career option and update them as per the industry demand. Our today's topic is very much relevant with the skill gap and the employment scenario of today's situation. Our today's topic is bridging the skill gaps to make Indian students more employable. And today we have a renowned and eminent speaker from the industry. We have Dr. Bhimaraya Maitri, Director, Indian Institute of Management, Nagpur. I welcome you, sir, on this platform. Dr. Maitri is having vast experience in the areas of management of quality, supply chain management, service management, and project management. We have another guest, Dr. Manpreet Singh Manna, former director, All India Council of Technical Education, Government of India, New Delhi. Dr. Manna also works as a director of the Swayam MOOCs project and Prime Minister Special Scholarship Scheme. So I welcome you, sir, on this platform. And we also have Professor Ujjwal K. Chaudhary, educationist and media professional, as a moderator for today's webinar. Dr. Chaudhary is also a pro vice chancellor of Adamas University, Calcutta. And I, Abhishek Shroti, representing training and placement department. And I'm also one of the speakers of this webinar. I will represent ISET Group of Universities. So once again, I welcome all the panelists and attendees on this webinar. And I'm sure that this webinar will helpful for all the attendees to decide the right course for employment and right place for study. So now I request and hand over the platform to Professor Ujjwal Chaudhary. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Abhishek, and thank you, the ISET Group of Universities, and also ASMA for organizing a very, very topical issue, a webinar on that. As would like to normally tell that, you know, manel is not a great idea. It should be a panel, and there should be a lady panelist always in every panel that we make going ahead. So that's just an observation I'd like to make at the very beginning. Not that any of the aspect will miss out, hopefully not. We have really a great panel together with us, but usually it's always good to have a balanced and inclusive panel. Moving ahead, the topic given is very critical, particularly in times today when we are moving from a purely offline education to currently online and then to a blended mode of education. In fact, Dr. Manna has actually brought in this power of online courses much earlier than what it entails today through Swayam and many other initiatives like that. So we have Dr. Manna from the technology field with the skills as the focus. and as you can see, skills comes behind his behind him as well in the image. So skills is the focus. And we have Dr. Maitri. Dr. Maitri is a doyen of management education, business education, education of entrepreneurship. So he will bring another big angle aspect that we shall have while dealing with the topic. The areas that we will look at, one, sectoral based or industry focused learning. Can we move beyond theoretical and degree focused learning? Okay, degree is a byproduct, great idea. But the focus has to be on sector or industry, particularly in technology education and in management education. How can we do that? Number two, academic industry collaboration, academia industry collaboration. What I would call as I-Cube, industry institute interface, I-Cube. Particularly when there is a digital disruption of the workplace, many, many companies have officially accepted work from home. There are various means of integrating work from home and work from office. So there is a digital disruption out there. So how education institutes can prepare the talent for such a disruption. Third, in-demand professional programs post-pandemic. I am sure we are looking at certain new areas. They were there, AI, ML, or cryptocurrency, or blockchain, or smart cities, or IoT of things, Internet of Things. All of these were there. But the way it has come now, face to face, in a much bigger and influential manner in the industry. So what sort of in-demand professional programs can be developed on that? Counseling by institutions to students. Now, students are coming from one particular background. Just now, we know class 12 exams are not being done. So there will be marking on the basis of the past results, whatever. So now they are coming from one background. The industry is in another orbit by itself, and the university system comes in between. So how, and not just post-graduation education, but undergraduate and postgraduate together. So how do we really integrate this counseling as a function for the institutions, by the institutions for students, and how students can evolve self-learning? Whatever we do at the institute, there will be a large areas where self-learning, learning to evolve by themselves, learning through projects, learning new skills, upskilling and reskilling at the student's level, at the learner's level, would be there. And finally, while we prepare our talent for our domestic industry, how do we prepare them for the global economy also, for the global employment as well? These are the some of the areas. I've taken the first 3-4 minutes to highlight the areas on which we can focus. And we will start with Dr. Maitri, who is the director of IIM Nagpur, as has been already said. The entire IIM ecosystem is giving a great leadership to business education in this country. IIM Nagpur, comparatively younger institute, but has already made a mark in this short period. So Dr. Bhimarao Maitri, I would like to request you to pick up any of these things that has been highlighted at this point and give how management education can evolve for this new situation, which is not an incremental situation, but a mega paradigm shift that's happening. Over to Dr. Maitri.
Thank you, Professor Ujjwal Chaudhary ji. I think as usual, your opening remarks always comprehensive and also very, very futuristic and sense-making. And thank you very much. So I would like to begin with, all of you know that the pandemic has changed every aspect of the life, including education sector, and management is not exception to that. Now, if you look at the change, the speed of change is tremendous, and speed of change has taken over the size of the organizations. Now, speed is more important than the size of the organization. So, that speed of change, because of digital disruption, because of technological advancement, is changing the education sector tremendously, and that also in higher speed. What was possible 10 years back, that was impossible 20 years back. and what was possible 20 years back, that was impossible 30 years back. And just before pandemic, face to face was the only education which can provide the best education. That was the assumption. Under that assumption, entire world was going with higher education. Even though Dr. Manpreet ji started online and all, but it was a sideline. So it was not at mainline. And today, whatever the dream, AICT under the leadership of Manpreet Singh ji started online. Today that has become mainline, which was never thought anybody before pandemic that is going to be mainline. Today that has become mainline, and which was mainline that has become offline. So what was possible that became impossible, and what was impossible that became possible because of one COVID-19 pandemic. So in such kind of disruptions, one pandemic is disruption, tsunami is disruption, and digital world, this industry 4.0 and advancement of technology, machine learning, IoT, deep learning, and 3D printing, they have changed every aspect of businesses. And that is how disruption is happening very often. It is like a flowing water in a river. Once water flows, you can't touch the same water again. So it means old has not dead and new has not born. We are always in the transition stage. The moment disruption happens, old context disappears and new context comes, and we are in a transition. The moment we gear up and we become proficient in the new disruption, third disruption comes and it will disrupt the second one. So this is how we are always in a transition stage. In such kind of transition stage, we are now preparing the students lead the businesses in a fluid world. I use the term fluid world because future is fluid. Leadership is fluid because even leader may change or may not change, the context is changing. And leadership style has to change, that is why leadership is fluid. Similarly, next word, uncertainty in a fluid, F-L-U-I-D, U stands for uncertainty, U stands for, you know, uncertain context. Context is changing like water. So that is how the context is very often changing, and context, uncertain context or unimaginable context is also fluid. And next word of the fluid, that is I stands for intellectual capital, and Accenture coined the very beautiful term liquid workforce. Intellectual capital, today's and tomorrow's intellectual capital, they are going to lead the world, those who are fluid. That is the liquid workforce. Liquid workforce means the moment you put the water into any container, water will take the shape of that container. And today's and tomorrow's workforce is a liquid workforce. They have to skill, they have to reskill, they have to upskill, as Ujjwalji rightly said. They have to learn, they have to unlearn, and they have to new learn. And learning and new learning may be taught and they can learn by observation, but unlearning is a toughest task. It is never taught, and everybody, those who develop the expertise of unlearning, they are going to lead the world. Unlearning is a toughest task. So in this kind of context, we are now preparing the students leading the fluid world. Now, and D stands for digital strategy. Every time in this digital world, new technology is emerging, new ICT is emerging in the form of IoT, deep learning, machine learning, cloud computing, you name many, and smart, robots. And one by one, robots are taking many jobs, and out of 1200 human behaviors, 65 behaviors have been already incorporated into the robots. They can smell, they can test. So in this kind of, that is how the strategy, digital strategy is also fluid. So entire fluid, each words of the fluid are fluid in this current digital world. So in such a context, we are running the higher education, preparing the students for leading the fluid world. And fluid world, I mean, we are preparing the students for unborn roles in an unborn company. I repeat, we are preparing our students, tomorrow's students, tomorrow's generation Z, for unborn roles forget about the sectors, forget about the product, unborn roles in an unborn company. Whether it is a two-year management or four-year engineering, the moment they join, at that time that role is not exist, company is not exist, but the moment they graduate, they entirely get into a disruptive kind of company and disruptive kind of product. So how to prepare the student that kind of role and that kind of company, that is the biggest challenge for higher education. As far as management education is concerned, I must say our three objective for management education used to be knowledge, skill and attitude. Now knowledge is easily available with Google. Skill, now it is not once you train the students in graduation and till generation to generation they used to, you know, work in one company with the same skill, but that has now disappeared. Skilling, reskilling is happening. So skill part, continuously upgradation, perpetual learners are going to lead the world. So that is why skilling, competency building has to happen very often. Even after graduation, they have to come back, they have to learn and they have to upgrade. That 1 year experience cannot be repeated for 20 years. That is not going to happen. So third important component is attitude, that being part, you know, today, three important buzzwords all over the world coming. One is ethics. Second one is, you know, we are talking about sustainability. Third one is governance, ESG. Ethics, sustainability and governance. These three words are going to play the world, and Mother Earth is already in a lot of pain and the COVID has come and lot of relief. The all living beings have got and except human being. We have troubled everybody, now we have got the trouble. So in this kind of environment, ethics, sustainability and governance, you know, four sustainable development goals also have to be one has to keep in mind in MBA education in future too. So that is where keeping these things in mind, what my take on the skill gap in the sense, you know, earlier students used to come to the college knowledge, that knowledge Google is giving. Earlier, nowadays, last 10 years, students are coming to the college for skilling. But now skill itself is, you know, roles are changing and people are average business life cycle is only 23.5 years. People are changing the jobs and in the same company, they are changing the role and in another company, new job role is coming. So skilling and reskilling upgradation has to take place. So liquid workforce has to be there. So for that, how to prepare the students? Apart from that, the fourth most important in management education, of course, in any education, I must say, knowledge they will get from Google as well as college. Skill they will get from college and on their own, as Ujjwalji rightly said, learning to learn. New education policy, important fundamental principle, learning to learn. That has to happen in education sector. That has to happen in management education. So that kind of thing one has to come. And learning to learn come only when we change our pedagogy, we change our curriculum, we change our mindset. And that is where knowledge, skill, attitude, that is a big part. Attitude means probably everybody will agree Indian ethos are the best in the world. And use the model curriculum also.
We'll get back to you again. If you could summarize the point now, I'll get back to you again, second round.
And fourth most important part is a capability. Now management education has to focus on capability. That is, a capability means building the mindset. It is different from this, you know, competency building. Building the mindset, it is a growth mindset. We have to create a student for growth mindset. And to do these four, we have to introduce a pedagogy that is a phenomena-based learning. We have introduced a pedagogy that is a project-based learning. Right. We have introduced the phenomena that is a live project, a group of students and group of kids teaching the students, and they are guiding and students are leading, and they will experience this kind of experience learning. You give not only knowledge, not only skill, not only being, but also a growth mindset. With this, I'll stop here.
Thank you. From a change paradigm to a growth mindset, the entire journey has been well tracked by you, particularly in the context of business education. And you very rightly said that the speed of change is extraordinary in current times. So digital disruption is a major disruption. It's now no more a jargon. It's a reality. The disruption is so big. UNESCO says 52% of Indian students didn't have 1 ounce of education in the last 1 year because of digital divide. And the remaining 48% had different levels because everyone is not at the same level of digital connectivity. So disruption is indeed very big. As you have rightly said, we are moving into an era of VUCA, as people say. We all know how even before the pandemic had come, the VUCA phenomenon had redefined our life in a big way. Volatile, uncertain, chaotic, and ambiguity. Chaotic or complex and ambiguity. These were the things that were defining our new age workplace, a new age skill set. But what you have said, growth mindset, that will emerge from a redefining VUCA itself. So volatile would move to values and vision. Uncertainty would lead to understanding of this uncertainty, understanding of the situation, and chaotic will lead to collaborate and creativity. Competition is a wrong priority now. Collaboration is the right priority, and also creativity, because we need to find innovative ways of solving the older problems or the newer problems. And finally, ambiguity to be replaced by agility, because the speed, you have yourself mentioned about speed repeatedly, how agility or nimbleness becomes the critical point. So in this context of changing dimensions, what you have spoken in the business education sector, can we now look at the technology education sector, where the skills are even more important? Skills are everywhere important, but technology requires the skills even more. So Dr. Manpreet Singh Manna, who has actually headed India's technology education's apex body AICT and has been a great votary for skill-based education and also bringing in online and blending it with offline, this he has been talking about for long. So Dr. Manna, your interpretations of something that you have been as a visionary talking for long in today's context, the today's context of the pandemic and the post-pandemic times. Over to you, Dr. Manna.
Thank you, Professor Ujjwal. And it was really very greatly elaborated by Professor Maitri, because he's such a learned person on the post of director of one of the Indian Institute of Management. So of course, his words of wisdom makes a sense. I just want to touch the other side of this. Just recall, 20 years before, we never thought of that in the ministries itself, there will be one exclusive ministry of skill development. Have we ever thought there is a one exclusive cell is required, so-called NSDC, National Skill Development Cell, and it's an autonomous body. And AICT spent 2 years to be creating one curriculum, NSQF, National Skill Qualification Framework. 72 qualifications we brought it. Although skill is not the part to taught in the engineering colleges, not at all. In engineering, we are giving competency, not skills. Skilling is something coming from the schools, coming from the parenting, coming from the society. I'll talk, there are, as per my perception or my learning till date, in my 50 years of age, I could see skills in the 4 broad areas. Ancient Indian skills, nobody can deny it. It's a core ancient Indian skills. आप जानना चाहते हैं शास्त्रों में जाइए, ग्रंथों में जाइए, आपको घुड़सवारी, आपको तीरंदाजी, आपको तैराकी, आपको वहां मिलेगी. चाणक्य नीति भी आपको पढ़ने को मिलेगी, तो वो ancient Indian skills ही कहलाएंगी. This is the patent. Now come to the knowledge based skills. माँ ने बच्ची को बोला कि बेटी आ तुझे मैं रोटी पकाना सिखाती हूँ. पिता ने पुत्र को बोला आ तुझे मैं साइकिल चलाना सिखाता हूँ. ये आ रही है, ये साथ में चल के आ रही है. देन तीसरी हमने ऐड की हमारे बच्चों के लिए टेक्नोलॉजी बेस्ड स्किल्स. व्हेन आई स्टडीड जीडब्ल्यू बेसिका ड्यूरिंग माय 93 पास आउट बीटेक एंड टुडे आई हैव बीन आस्क्ड मायसेल्फ टू टीच समथिंग पाइथन. व्हाट इज दैट? एज ऑफ द स्किल इज 4, नॉट मोर देन 4 इयर्स. बट हमें तो 60 साल जीवित रहना है, हमें तो 80 साल जीवित रहना है. सो स्किलिंग अ स्टूडेंट इज नॉट ओनली स्किलिंग द स्टूडेंट, आई थिंक स्किलिंग आवरसेल्फ फर्स्ट, बीइंग अ टीचर, बीइंग अ मैनेजर, बीइंग अ ह्यूमन बीइंग, being a social person, being a politician even, we have to be skill, means unskill, reskill, and of course upskill. It is all way. Kyunki aap mujhe kahein ki kaksha mein jaake Manna ji bullet train padhaiye, sir main to steam engine padh ke aaya hu, main bullet train kaise padhaunga? We are revising the curriculum. Humne revise kiya bahut acche se, sir hum 3 saal mein change kar dete hain, hum ye kar dete hain. Bhai sahab, aap Ohm's law to nahi nikal paaye. Although you could bring something VLSI, but Ohm's law is still there. You can't. So basic thing is, skill should not be get confused with any kind of competency of any topic, any area of learning. हम यहाँ पे थोड़ा सा confusion create करना शुरू कर दिया. हमने कहा engineering करवा दो, engineering करवाने से skill नहीं आती. मैं आज भी इस देश में इतने matriculate बच्चों को जानता हूँ जो मेरे IIT pass out से भी, मैं यहाँ से गर्व से कह सकता हूँ, ज्यादा कमा पा रहे हैं, सिर्फ उसके हाथ में एक skill है. भगवान कृष्ण, ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूं, शास्त्रों में लिखा, भगवान कृष्ण के पास 16 कलाएं थी, टोटल 16 कलाएं कही जाती हैं. देयर आर टोटल 16. आज हम 20 200 जो मर्जी काउंट करें 16 होती हैं. हम कहते हैं जिसके पास चार भी आ जाए ना 16 में से, तुम कहते यार तुम तो बड़े महान हो, तुम्हें चार कलाएं आती हैं. और भगवान कृष्ण ने भी उस समय पर कहा था कि कुछ कलाएं तो मैं तुम्हें दे सकता हूं, कुछ कलाएं तुम्हें वहीं पर बैटल साइट पर ही लेनी पड़ेंगी. मैं भी आज अपने स्टूडेंट्स को यह कहता हूं, बेटा मैं आपको इतनी इंजीनियरिंग दे दूंगा, इतनी स्किल्स दे दूंगा, लेकिन जब आप मार्केट में उतरेंगे ना, ये वो वाली स्किल्स हैं जो हिडन है, वो मुझे भी आज नहीं पता थी, आपको पता चलेगा चक्रव्यूह कैसे तोड़ना है. तो अभिमन्यु का चक्रव्यूह तो आप समय पे ही तोड़ पाएंगे, लेकिन मैं अपने बच्चे को कम से कम इस लेवल तक तो बना के मार्केट में निकालूं कि उसको अगर अपने आप स्किल्स इनहांसमेंट करनी पड़ जाए, लर्निंग करनी पड़ जाए, तो कम से कम पीछे मुड़ के ना आए मेंटर के पास, सर आप कहां हैं, मुझे नई स्किल्स सीखनी है. नहीं, और ये हो रहा है. आई टेल यू 80% of my Indian students, if they are learning the skills after the B.Tech only. Chemical engineers आज जाके Google में क्यों बैठे हैं, Facebook में बैठे हैं? मैंने तो कभी उनको IT नहीं पढ़ाया. I never taught any kind of SQL or any kind of this Python. They learned it even out of the campus. They learned it maybe SWAM, maybe you know Coursera, maybe any kind of platforms they have. मेरा यहाँ पर मुद्दा ये है, gap आज से 100 साल पहले भी था, गैप आज भी है, गैप कल भी रहेगा. क्योंकि गैप इसलिए रहेगा कि हम एक जनरेशन से पढ़े और अगली जनरेशन को पढ़ा रहे, तो तीन जनरेशन का गैप है मेरे भाई, तीन जनरेशन का गैप है. मुझे पढ़ाने वाला मुझसे एक जनरेशन अप था और मुझे जिसको पढ़ाना मुझसे एक जनरेशन छोटी है, तो गैप तो रहेगा. लेकिन इस गैप को अगर हम थोड़ा सा ब्रिज करना चाहते हैं, तो हम उनके अंदर आज अगर आप गूगल पे लिखेंगे ना टॉप 20 स्किल्स, तो आपको खुशी होगी जान के कि पहली 5 में क्रिएटिविटी आ रही है, पहली 7 में अडॉप्टेबिलिटी आ रही है, पहली 3 में कोलैबोरेशन आ रही है. आप गूगल आउट कर लीजिए, राइट, टॉप 20 स्किल्स टू बी रिक्वायर्ड ऑन टुडे, यानी कि आज भी जीवित है जो हमने 100 साल पहले भी कहा था, अडॉप्टेबिलिटी. बेटा अपने महल से निकलो, जाके कुटिया में जाकर शिक्षा ग्रहण करो, तब तुम्हें राजतिलक देंगे, जाके अपने गुरु जी के वहां पर आप अपना वास करें. तभी तो गुरुकुल कहलाया था. कौन से कुल में जाना है? गुरुकुल में जाना है, स्कूल में जाना है. वहां पे आप ये नहीं कह सकते बच्चों को कि बेटा तेरे घर में बाथरूम में एसी लगा हुआ है, तुझे एनआरई हॉस्टल में एडमिशन देनी पड़ेगी. देन देयर इज नो स्किलिंग. स्किलिंग मींस रिक्वायर्ड एनवायरनमेंट. अगर बच्चे को रंधा चलाना सिखाना है ना, तो उसको कारपेंटर के वहां छोड़ के आना पड़ेगा, एसी में खड़ा होकर रंधा नहीं चला सकेगा. तो हम स्किल्स देने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं एम्बियंस में. एम्बियंस में स्किल्स भी दी जाती है. एम्बियंस में आप परोस के दे रहे हो उसको, आप डोसा परोसिए इडली, लेकिन डोसा बनाने के लिए किचन में जाना पड़ेगा, ये उसको बताना पड़ेगा. So we have to keep ready our brigade, our youngsters, without giving any freebies, without giving any undisclosed things. बेटा चार दूंगा, चार तो तुम्हें मार्केट में जाके खुद ही सीखनी पड़ेगी जब तुम्हारे सिर के ऊपर पड़ने वाली है. किसी ने हमें पहले सिखाया था मास्क कैसे बनाना है, किसी ने ऑटोमोबाइल इंडस्ट्री को बताया था वेंटिलेटर कैसे बनाने हैं, आज ऑटोमोबाइल इंडस्ट्री वेंटिलेटर कैसे बना रही है. उनके तो इंजीनियर्स तो मारुति कार सीख के आए थे, चेसी कैसे बनानी, इंजन कैसे बनाना है, वो वेंटिलेटर कैसे बनाने लगे. उन्होंने कि बीटेक में वेंटिलेटर बनाया था, एमटेक में बनाया था. क्यों? मौके पर जब आपके ऊपर ऐसी आपदा विपदा आती है, तो स्किल्स अपने आप अंदर से निकल के आ जाती हैं. सिर्फ उनको निकालने वाली प्रतिभा क्रिएट करनी चाहिए. आई थिंक वी शुड गिव द इकोसिस्टम, वी शुड गिव द एनवायरमेंट, द स्किलिंग शुड कम बाय इनहेरेंसी, बाय डीएनए. और हिंदुस्तान तो मशहूर है, भारतवर्ष तो वैसे ही कौशल देश है, हमारी तो स्किल हमारे डीएनए में ऑलरेडी है, हमें सिर्फ उसको एक फिनिशिंग टच देना होता है.
Thank you. The way you speak is very, you know, is very understandable for the man on the street as well, for educated and average. Everyone can understand the way, and the way you connected ancient Indian skills, moving on to knowledge-based skills, moving on to technology-based skills, and then you differentiated between learning, education, skills. All the three, then differentiated between skills learnt in camp on campus and skills learnt in life. That's what was Dr. Maitri talking about, learning to learn, learning on your own, self-learning, because that itself is a major skill going ahead. You talked about a very beautiful example of a concept of unskill, reskill, upskill. Unskill, Once upon a time, Java, C, C++, these were very important skills. Today, not so much. And there is not much of a requirement also to go into depth of it. That's the unskilled part. Then reskill. New skills have come in. Like today, Python is very significant. You have mentioned that. It may not be 10 years or 7 years down the line, but this moment, Python is a critical skill. And upskill, going to the next level, when we are talking of blockchain or artificial intelligence or machine learning. So that's the next level. Or IoT, Internet of Things, that's the upskill part. So this is this evolution of skills you have rightly brought in. Teacher skills, I would like to mention here. Teacher, the word was a sage on the stage, was what for a sage on the stage who prepares the syllabus, speaks the last word and introduces the topic, speaks the last word and evaluates. But we have moved away from that. The disruption that is going on which Dr. Maitri had spoken earlier, this disruption is making the teacher a mentor, a co-learner of the learner. However experience we three might have in our life, depending on our experience and age, but many things are coming, many of which we didn't know earlier. We didn't know earlier, and we're actually learning as we mentor our learners. As they learn, some of the things we are learning today. I'll honestly tell, I knew Skype before the pandemic. Today, I know 10 platforms. I mean, we are just now on Zoom, one WebEx, nothing rocket science. But the point is that the 10 platforms from Webinar Jam to Geo Meet to WebEx to MS Teams to Google Meet, we didn't know this, StreamYard. We didn't know, and there are certain different functions, different interactive elements. So these are things that we pick up as we go. So teachers have to be now become mentors, where mentor prepares his own proprietary knowledge, proprietary learning resource, like a video, self-video, a podcast, or let's say a PowerPoint. And these they put up before the learner, along with aggregated learning resources, like the SWAM, aggregated learning, open source, free MOOCs, you know, SWAM. Or there is paid open learning also, paid online learning also, like Coursera or LinkedIn Learning. So these, plus there are YouTube videos and other things about the topic that you have taken, case studies, as Dr. Bhimrao Maitri was speaking about case study-based learning as well. All these learning resources have to be placed before the learner. I'm talking of higher learning, higher education, much before the class comes, much before the synchronous learning comes. These have to put up for what you call as a flip classroom learning or asynchronous learning. And then the synchronous can be digital, can be physical. Physical for more for the group assignments, peer assignments, for practical, for lab, for studio. And digital synchronous can be for more conceptual learning. So teachers also have to evolve now to do this. And this is the whole entire delivery of the learning resources, engagement of the learner online and offline, and evaluation of the learner, which was all offline earlier, now online, proctored online, you know, open book online, and then offline. Offline could be quiz, presentations, all those. Quiz can be online as well. So this mix of or blend of this is a completely new skill for the learner. Completely new skill that we have to move in. You have talked about creativity, collaboration, and adaptability. Very right points you have talked as some of the key skills across all domains. Across all domains. And I would add innovation, teamwork, crisis management, and leadership to it. Because at the same time, we are a leader and we are also a team worker. We need to innovate and we also need to manage crisis. Well, life and workplace is full of crisis. We know that. So thank you for your comments, both of you. I request now Mr. Abhishek Shruti. Abhishek G is the head of training and placement in Rabindranath Tagore University. I really like the name of your university. My dearest, my very closest literature. I'm from Bengal. I've gone to Shantiniketan more than 12 times. So Rabindranath Tagore is in our blood. But, you know, from the childhood, we are taught a lot of songs and philosophy of Tagore and how it has evolved. Tagore's philosophy has not been a constant. It has always evolved at different times, but that's another issue. At the university, I'm sure you're taking a lot of modern means of connecting the students to the learners, I should say, not students much, learners to the modern skills or the modern attitudes that's required. So I would ask to you, how do we reimagine education to develop job-relevant curricula? You know, curricula in many places is old school. So there's a new concept of outcome-based curriculum now. So how do you reimagine education to develop job relevant curricula and the industry academia collaboration, which has already been touched by the other speakers? If you could take it to the next level of how do you really actualize it? The concept, the vision has been told by Dr. Maitri and Dr. Manna. How do we really execute it? Over to Mr. Abhishek with these queries.
Thank you, Professor Ujjwal sir, for asking this question. So I'm giving the example of my own university. At ICET Group of University, we basically have a skill-based curriculum with skill credit in each semester. So currently we have 50 skills option available for all the students who are taking the admission and doing different courses like the PG and the graduation courses. So I'm giving one example, if any student from commerce background, if he want to do some sort of elective subject or subject in graphic designing or mushroom cultivation. So there is an option through the elective subject. So he or she can choose that subject and the credit is also available in the examination. And similarly, if we talk about the IT and CS student, they want to choose some sort of elective subject, they can choose multimedia and designing, the web designing courses, part of their regular subject. So in entire university, we have 50 skill course available in our university. And you talk about the industry academic collaboration. So we are associated with the Micro Focus HPA offering specialized programs in various technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning and cybersecurity and big data. And a part of this, we have 500 plus collaboration for training, development and placement of these students. And we are also tied up with Coursera, the online platform, and National Skill Development Corporation for imparting these skill courses during their graduation and post-graduation. And a part of this, at AGU, we have Atal Incubation Center in our university. So we not only trained our student for the employment, but a part of this, we provide them a platform so that they can start their own venture and motivate them toward the self-employment. So this is my summation on the question.
Very good. Very good. You have given actually a case study how you do these things in a particular context. I will add one example that we do at our level. See, all our academic scores are heavily biased towards concepts and written exams so far. So we here developed a concept called ACE, Adamus Consolidated Excellence Score. ACE. So while the academic score of a particular semester can be at the level of 75% and according grade, but A score could be completely different because academic scores is 50% of the A score and the other 50% is co-curricular activities, social outreach, leadership activities, use of digital tools and library and learning to learn projects, real life projects, sports. All of these together is the other 50%, which actually checks many of the skills which the other two professors have already mentioned. So only academics does not give the full picture of the person's soft and hard skills, of the person's left and right brain synthesis, right being creative, aesthetic, and left being more rational, scientific, and logical. So therefore, this concept of A score, and when we send the CVs to the placement, for placement to the organizations, we are mentioning the academic score and we are mentioning the A score as well, because that's much more comprehensive, much more consolidated, and much more holistic in our opinion. That's one example of how we are trying to bridge with a proper blend of the two. We are supposed to have this discussion till 3 p.m. And if I'm not wrong, we are at 15 minutes more to go for 3. So we'll have a quick round, second round of, I just request not to take more than 2 to 3 minutes so that we can finish the entire round satisfactorily. So Dr. Maitri, you are a very senior professor and a leader in management education. Give 1, 2, 3 points for the management colleges, whether they are independent autonomous management colleges or they are part of a university. 1, 2, 3, 4 that they must implement now, next 6 months, now in 2021. Your suggestion, sir.
Thank you, Professor Ujjwalji. I think after listening to Professor Manpreet Singh Ji and Professor Abhishek, so 4 points for the management education. Point number one, I think the point number one is along with the change, universities and institutions or business school should also align the change. Basically, they should be the first one to capture the technology, changing technology. They should never be the last one. So that is the first one. They should capture the technology and incorporate it into the education system to make it as a more digital institute or digital university that is need of an hour, number one. Number two, leadership style has to change. The way we led the business schools as a director, as a head of the department, 10 years, 20 years back, that I tell you follow are democratic, participative. Those days are gone. Now the style of leadership has to be empower your younger people, all the faculty members and staff, empower, listen to them, encourage them, motivate them to do better to the shared objective of the institution. Number two, that is empowerment. Number three, the universities and institutions, they have to change their pedagogy and curriculum. Curriculum, they have to continuously fine-tune, basically equip the curriculum as per the needs of the corporate world, not only today's needs, but tomorrow's needs. It means business schools have to be a sense-making. 3 years down the line, what are the products are going to disappear and what new products are going to come? Keeping that in mind, they have to fine-tune the curriculum. Number four, and the most important one, the pedagogy they have to change. Evaluation they have to change. Pedagogy means phenomena-based learning. A group of faculty member, for example, merger and acquisition is a case given to the group of students. Faculty from finance, faculty from law, legal background, faculty from HR, faculty from information system, one is Oracle and one is SAP, how to integrate. In merger and acquisition, such kind of phenomena, students have to experience and study and come out with the innovative solutions. So that kind of phenomena-based learning, project-based learning, case-based learning, and the most important, learning to learn happens with game-based learning. So because the moment game starts, they will learn from the mistakes. And at the same time, learning to learn happens to the students without faculty support. So this kind of pedagogy they should adopt, and if they do that, probably that business school will lead and many will follow that. With this, I'll stop here. Thank you very much, Ujjwal.
Very well said. And what we missed in our first round, you brought very well, gamification. Gamification in education, how do you use games aided with these modern technologies, aided with ICT, which can actually engage people in an entertaining manner and yet drive home the points, drive home the learning. I find today the youngsters learn much faster. I have a daughter who is 24-year-old, and they learn much faster when they learn through games. Sometimes these games are also a bit of, you know, apparently bit of time waste. But I have seen that at the end, there are certain key learnings that they have. The other point you said is interdisciplinary. No actual life business is only focused on one small dimension. There is an interdisciplinary learning there. So there is a bit of law, there is a bit of HR, there is a bit of technology, engineering, there is a bit of finance, yes. So there are five or six elements that get into any business. Someone may be an expert in one, but has to have a basic background and strong background of multiple things before specializing in one, if someone has to be really go into a leadership position in a business. Thank you, Dr. Maitri and Dr. Manna here. Now, the same question, if engineering colleges, which are in real financial crisis across the country, which I'm sure you are much more aware than me, excepting the first 400-500 engineering colleges, almost all others have some problem or the other, because engineering on one side are seen to be producing talent which cannot be immediately gainfully employed, and on the other side sometimes are seen to be peddling or rather delivering skills which are a bit off, bit irrelevant, a bit obsolete. That's another one side. Then there are too many sometimes, and too less in certain places. Infrastructure is a challenge. There are several issues, you know that. Let me not go get into the litany of problems. Let me ask you, if you were advising AICT today, if you were the same organization which you headed, if you were advising the best of the engineering college, if not the best, the second line of the engineering colleges, what five things would you suggest to them, keeping pandemic in mind and keeping the current situation of engineering led careers in mind? Over to Dr. Manna.
Thank you. I think if I have to say five, it will be injustice. Rather, more than five solutions already be given by Government of India through NEP 2020. If this 72 pages of worth PDF file can be downloaded by any management of the engineering institution, forget it, engineering institution, any university out of 900 plus universities in my country, I think you just have to understand the proper English and interpretation of that language. I'll just take note more than 5 minutes. We started somewhere 7-8 years back, Prime Minister Kaushal Vikas Yojana. When we opened from AICT, not from that side, PMO side, that was a separate. AICT was exclusive PMKVY for our affiliated institutions, approved institutions, 10,000 plus, whether you are having a pharmacy or you're having an art craft, you're having a management or engineering. But we asked a simple thing. After 4:30, you logged your lab and you have the yellow bus culture. In my country, other than IITs and some of the NITs, most of the institutions are not the residential institutions. And I don't think the engineering happening with this kind of culture by 5, because engineering starts after 5 p.m. Because daytime, it's the lecturing only. You have to attend the lectures as per the schedule. And engineering is unscheduled thing. It doesn't have any timetable. You go in the lab, you do something out of the box. You have to do something on Arduino. You have to do something on a PCB. You have to do something on that. At home, you don't have these kind of resources. I'm sorry. So if your labs are underutilized, as the NBS says, as the NAC says, as per the Washington Accord says, the utilization factor, can't you allow the nearby students of the community, those even not visited the school even for the matric class, ask them to have some skills? Maybe some welding, maybe some soldering, maybe some painting, designing, anything. Just give them rooms, give them shelter, give them place, and you could do. And many people could do this. Many institutions could do this. And it was another formula behind that. We immediately given in the next year, DVOC and BVOC. What was that? Don't ask for PCM. Don't ask for English. If any student who have little much knowledge of that he can write his name on the form, he can come for the diploma in vocational, bachelor in a vocational, because your institution also needs some breather. Unless you utilize your equipments, your resources, you cannot have the revenue. IRG is very poor. In India, still we are talking always CSR, but we never talk about the IRG, institutional revenue generation. You both spoken so nicely about your universities. You know how many consultancy you people are bringing, how many short-term programs you are conducting in AWS as well as the ASIT. I believe these universities all both start from A only. So you are really category A university. As you spoken, I never visited any of this university, but I believe what you spoken, you must be the UGC mentor university. Because today now UGC announced, we should be have a mentor. Aap margdarshak baniye. Aapke bagal mein koi nayi university khadi ho gayi hai, institute khada ho gaya, aap uski ungli pakde. आप उसको बोले अगर तुम्हारे पास अगर ये 1 करोड़ का इक्विपमेंट नहीं है, हमारे पास डीएसटी का इक्विपमेंट आ गया है, एएसटी का आ गया, आप अपनी फैकल्टी को यहाँ भेज दो। हमें इन ईगो से भी बाहर आना होगा, हमें इस कल्चर से भी बाहर आना होगा। आपने कहा कि क्या प्रावधान होने चाहिए, व्हाट आर द 5-पॉइंट फार्मूला, हैव यू नोटिस दैट मल्टीपल एंट्री मल्टीपल एग्जिट कॉन्सेप्ट, इट इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। मैट्रिक तक जिस बच्चे के साथ मैं पढ़ रहा हूँ वो मेरा दोस्त हो गया, जिसको हम कहते हैं पापा मेरा लंगोटिया यार, पापा वो कॉमर्स ले रहा है मैं कॉमर्स लूंगा, पापा उसने बीटेक में एडमिशन ले ले बेटा, पापा कहाँ रोक रहा है? After 1 year when he came to know it's not my cup of tea, I'm not happy with this kind of skills, but I'm going to get. But he don't have to choice to go to the junior batch. Now, तू जहाँ जहाँ चलेगा, मेरा साया साथ होगा. That is ABC, Academic Bank of Credit. You take these credits what you have spent with me and go to other institution and take your skills what you are looking for. तुम्हें 4 साल तक सिस्टम में रहने के लिए बोला किसने है मेरा भाई? अगर तुम 1 साल की स्किल्स लेके भी उतना इंजीनियर जितना काम कर सकते हो, you take skills and go, because 5 उंगलियां कभी बराबर नहीं होती हैं। आपकी क्लास में आज भी फास्ट लर्नर्स बैठ रहे हैं, आज भी स्लो लर्नर्स बैठ रहे हैं। स्लो लर्नर्स को डिग्री 5 साल में भी प्राप्त हो सकती है और फास्ट लर्नर को 1 साल में। अभी यंगेस्ट प्रोफेसर आप गूगल पे लिखिए, यंगेस्ट प्रोफेसर ऑफ द वर्ल्ड, 7 साल का बच्चा, 7 ईयर्स ओल्ड गाय इज अ प्रोफेसर नॉट इन इंडिया, इन यूएस यूनिवर्सिटी। रीजन बींग, उन्होंने उसके टैलेंट को देखकर, स्किल्स को देखकर, फ्लुएंसी को देखकर, कम्युनिकेशन को देखकर प्रोफेसर का टैग दिया ना। हमें भी ये चीज, और ये एसीटी में हुआ था, आज से 5 साल पहले एक बच्चे का बायोडाटा आया था, उस टाइम मैडम होती थी हमारी मंत्रालय में, स्मृति रानी जी, क्या इस बच्चे को बीटेक दे सकते हैं शास्त्र बुद्धे जी? हमने उसके स्पेशल टेस्ट करवाए, वो बच्चा एक्स्ट्रा टैलेंटेड था, तो 17 साल के बच्चे को हमें बीटेक देनी थी, क्योंकि वो एक दिन में ही मैट्रिक एग्जाम दे के आ गया था, अगले दिन उसने प्लस टू के एग्जाम दे दिए थे। अब ऐसे एक्स्ट्रा टैलेंटेड बच्चों के लिए हमने कुछ इकोसिस्टम बनाया है? अगर नहीं बनाया तो एडिसन नहीं आने वाला देश में, शकुंतला देवी द्वारा नहीं दिखने वाली हमें। सो दीज फार्मूलाज, मल्टीपल एंट्री मल्टीपल एग्जिट एंड लैंग्वेज, अगर आज संस्कृत को ढंग से सिखा दिया जाए तो पूरे वर्ल्ड को हम राज करते हैं कॉम्पिटिशनल लैंग्वेजेस में। This is the one of the compact and best. मैं नहीं कह रहा, it's a NASA's wording. It's not my wording. Don't believe in me, but at least believe in NASA. Believe in ISRO. Two are the pillars for the satellite. So these kind of the fundamental things which already has been spoken. क्या कहा हमने? पहले क्या होता था? एक छोटी example देके conclude करूँगा। आपके बच्चे का first rank आ गया पूरे JEE Advanced में। आप बच्चे को क्या पूछते हो? बेटा कौन सी branch लेनी है? वो कहेगा mechanical. Okay बेटा, IIT बॉम्बे जाएंगे। पापा कंप्यूटर्स, ओके IIT कानपुर जाएंगे। पापा इलेक्ट्रिकल, ओके बेटा IIT दिल्ली जाएंगे। तो क्या IIT दिल्ली में मैकेनिकल नहीं पढ़ाई जाती? हमने क्या किया? डिस्टिंक्टिवनेस क्रिएट की हुई है। डिस्टिंक्टिवनेस, ये जो पर्टिकुलर यूनिवर्सिटी है ये मशहूर है एग्रीकल्चर के लिए, ये मशहूर है इलेक्ट्रिकल के लिए। अब बगल में जो रहता बच्चा है दिल्ली का, वो बॉम्बे तक क्यों जाएगा? यही कहा NEP में, आप क्लस्टराइजेशन तो करें लेकिन मल्टी डिसिप्लिनरी भी लेके आए। अगर हमारा बच्चा IIT दिल्ली में जाके आज BCom भी अच्छी कर सकेगा, क्योंकि उसको भी तो पिनाकल चाहिए, टैली चाहिए, पाइथन चाहिए, वो आपसे अच्छा कौन देगा? क्या हमारा कंप्यूटर इंजीनियर आपको e-commerce नहीं पढ़ा सकता? बिल्कुल पढ़ा सकता है एंड ऑफ द डे। तो यही कॉन्सेप्ट, ये चीजें हमारी स्किल्स को मल्टी स्किल्स प्रावधान में लेके जाती है। वी हैव टू बी ओपन माइंड, नॉट ओनली द एजुकेशन सिस्टम बट द फैकल्टी बट द मैनेजमेंट। इफ द गवर्नमेंट इज ओपन, आई थिंक नाउ इट्स अ टर्म टू वी पीपल शुड कम बिकम ओपन। Or I salute all the multidisciplinary universities in my country because they say, you come here, you opt what you want, show me 120 credits, take the graduation with the competency. Aur ye hone wala hai, no more BA, no more BCom, no more BSc. Yakeen kijiye 3-4 saal baad aapka bachcha sirf apne choice ke basket mein se courses karega, credits lega, aur jiske 70% credits match kar jayenge, उस कॉम्पिटेंसी की आप उसको स्पेशलाइजेशन देके आउट करने वाले हो। ये नहीं कि बेटा पहले साल भी फिजिक्स पढ़ेगा, केमिस्ट्री पढ़ेगा, मैथ्स पढ़ेगा, दूसरे साल भी पढ़ेगा। क्यों दूसरे साल में बायो नहीं पढ़ सकता क्या? बिल्कुल पढ़ सकते हैं। सो दिस इज व्हाट वी हैव टू मेक द ओपननेस एंड दिस इज गोइंग टू टच योर इंटरनल थॉट एंड थॉट बिकम स्किल्स। मैंने सोचा मैं चाय बना सकता हूं तो मेरे को चाय बनानी आ गई। मैंने सोचा मैं जहाज उड़ा सकता हूं तो मैं जहाज उड़ा सकूंगा। मुझे एक मेंटर की जरूरत पड़ेगी। वो मेंटर आपने पहले कह दिया कि आज टीचर को मेंटर बनना ही पड़ेगा, हमें फैसिलिटेटर बनना पड़ेगा, हमें अनेबलर बनना पड़ेगा, हमें एंजल बनना पड़ेगा, हमें एक्सीलेटर बनना पड़ेगा। टीचर बहुत बन के देख लिया, डंडा बहुत चला के देख लिया, अब हमें मेंटर ही बनना पड़ेगा।
थैंक यू, दिस इज वेरी गुड। यू नो वन ऑफ द पॉइंट्स दैट वाज टोल्ड ऑलरेडी ऑलवेज अबाउट एजुकेशन दैट एवरीवन इज यूनिक, सो यू कैन नॉट आस्क एवरीवन टू डू आइदर स्विमिंग और गो अप द ट्री। So, you know, and usually that fish and monkey story is always told about that. So everyone's uniqueness has to be found out and harnessed. Uniqueness as far as desire and as far as skill set is concerned. And multi-skilling, both at the institute level and at the individual level, multi-skilling is the way to go. There should be some core skills, but there can be many related skills which a learner can learn. And therefore, this concept also has been brought in the new education policy called major and minor. So a major can be in engineering, a minor can be in management, or a minor can be in communication, or a minor can be even in music for that matter. Sometimes, usually the major is from the head, minor can be an add-on or from the heart. So that's also another concept that's brought in the new education policy. Abhishek, last voice to you. We have only a minute to go. So what would you like to, what are you doing now to bring this, some examples you have already given, but bring these aspects that has been brought forth here, new education policies aspects, digitalization aspects, bringing skill, sectoral skills for good placement. What exactly one or two things you are doing? You can tell those examples. That could be a good case study.
Yes. So thank you, Professor Ujjwal. And only one thing I want to add on, on this discussion. So the internship is the very important parameter, I think, in all the courses, either that is engineering, management, or any other courses. So internship need to be mandatory in all the courses. And through internship, there are a lot of opportunity for the student to go for the final placements and the final employment in the industry. So internship need to be mandatory in all the courses.
Right. I would just add to that, internship now can be online and offline. And an offline internship may require a full-time attention. An online internship can be even partial, which can go along with the course even in normal months, the usual months. That's one point. And the second point, internship is not just a matter of engineering or management anymore. Can be of law, can be of media, can be of design, even can be of English literature. Who does an internship with an NGO or with a literary organization or with a publication? So internship is application of skills and knowledge in a particular given context in the industry or the society. And it can be and should be for every profession, every domain, commerce or economics or any domain it can be. I think we had a very, though it's only 60 minutes, but we had a compact learning in multiple languages, Hindi and English, and in multiple styles, academic and application oriented and case study based, multiple styles between Dr. Maitri, a great scholar, Dr. Manna, a great executionist, as can be understood from his entire presentation, and Mr. Shrotri, who also is implementing these ideas in a particular given context. I had a great pleasure. I noted many of your points. Otherwise, I couldn't have summed up after you talked. So it is a great learning. Even when we had World Education Conference, where I had the pleasure of listening to Dr. Maitri, he was actually moderating one session, if I'm not wrong, that time, and also speaking in another. So I had the great pleasure of learning from all of the speakers. So whether I'm 50 or 60 or 70, I shall always be a co-learner. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for a very engaging discussion. And perhaps we shall meet once again on some other platform. And surely someday offline as well, face to face as well. Namaste and bye.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you.